church. How you doing today? Come on, how you doing today? Hey, why don't you stand to your feet? My name's Trevor. This is my beautiful wife, Katrina. We're so excited to be here. The Bridge feels like home, feels like family to us. So come on, we love you to sing with us today as we enter into worship. Come on, let's sing this out. I count.
And I count on one thing. Same God who never fails, will not fail me now. It won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out.
Come on, you sing.
Yes, I will too high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Yes, I will.
Hey!
Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things.
Come on,
working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high.
Come on, let's worship.
You reign above it all.
Come on, everybody.
Jesus, you reign above it all. On the cross, the work was finished. God, you poured out your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, and hear an anthem arise. Jesus, you're alive.
Come on.
You reign above it all. You reign above it all. And over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, throned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, throned on the highest praise. Come on, you sing. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Seated alone in glory, throned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Seated alone. So Lord, we give you all the glory today. We give you all the praise. God, for everything that you've done, for everything that you are. And Lord, I'm encouraged in my heart today
as we get to come and bring you all the things that are weighing heavy on us, all the thoughts, the questions, the doubts, the fears, we get to come today. We get to choose to give you praise in the midst of whatever we're going through. In the midst of whatever we feel, we get to come and lay our crowns at your feet. We get to come and give back to you everything you gave to us. This new life in your love, this grace, this freedom, this peace. We get to come and lay it at your feet, God, and say, we may not know what the future holds, but Jesus, you do. And you made a way so that we could come to you. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. I just even encourage you, as the band plays, just begin just to say thank you. If that's where you are today and you've been, feel like you've been tossed back and forth, there's an opportunity for you today not to just sing words that are on a screen, but for you to come and give your heart, give your thanks to him. So even just take a moment now as they play. Just say in your own heart, in your own words, say it out loud if you want. Thank you, God.
Positions, your name, it stands above them all. and Trevor for leading us in worship this morning. Father, we just want to give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor, because there is none like you. We thank you this morning, Lord God, that you've opened our eyes to see this glorious day that you've given to us, Lord. The Father God, we get to come into your house and worship you in spirit and in truth, that there is none like you. Your name is holy. So, Father God, we just thank you for this time that we get with you, Lord God, to lift up our voices and sing unto your name. We thank you for the leading of Trevor and Trina, Lord God, but we thank you for your Holy Spirit that leads them, Lord God. Your Holy Spirit leads us into all things, and we thank you, Lord. Father, I just ask that you would just remain with us. Your presence right now, the way it is right now, Lord God, remain with us throughout the remainder of the service. We thank you and we give you praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated. Greet someone before you sit down this morning. Yes, say hello. Don't be afraid to say hello to your neighbor. Yes. Oh my gosh. Look at the stage. Look at the stage. Oh my goodness, I feel like I'm underwater right now. No, I'm not drowning, but I feel like I'm underwater. And I just want to give God thanks for that. I thank everybody. You guys know that leading into next week is our scuba ABC, and the kids are going to have a great time. I want to thank all of those that volunteered to create this atmosphere for our children. It's quite amazing. And so this morning, I just want to welcome you. If you're here for the first or the fifth or the 50th time, I welcome you this morning to the Bridge. If it is your first time, though, we would love to see you outside at the connection table outside towards my left, your right. We would love to meet you. I know Greg and the team is out there this morning. They would love to hear from you, get to know you, and just tell you a little bit about more about the Bridge. And so those that are online, there is that button that you can click, say hello, say good morning. We're waiting to hear from you today. And so today there's also, oh, I didn't introduce myself, did I? I always forget. My name's Lisa, and I get to serve on the Connections team and the prayer team here at the Bridge. All right, and so today is a special day. And so I hope you all stay until the end, because we have a treat for you. Yes, we do. It is, I think they call it Ice Cream Sunday. I don't know. You're going to get a treat after church, a nice, cool treat after church. So after Pastor Sam gives like his wonderful message and it's all like heated and stuff, you guys get to go and cool down with your ice cream treat. And so here at the Bridge, we want to thank you for being intentional in your giving. There's so many ways to give, either through push pay, online, and for us that love to drop our envelopes in the box, there is one at every exit in this building. And so we thank you for partnering with us in ministry here at the Bridge. We're so thankful for how you give to us so that we can do God's work out in this community. And so before I walk off the stage, I'm going to call Pastor Sam up, who will be delivering the message today. And I'm just going to pray for him as he comes. And so I just pray that we just remain in that attitude of worship as he gives his message, because I know God is going to use him powerfully today. And if you've been with us over the last little while, we've been going through our three series, Rest, Relationship, and
Restoration.
Yes, I think that's the most important one. After we've rest and we walk through our relationship, I think restoration is so key. And so I'm just going to pray for Pastor Sam this morning. Father, we just want to thank you for Pastor Sam. We thank you for his heart, Lord God, his humble heart, his service heart, Lord. And I pray that you would just use him this morning, that everything that is spoken from his lips comes directly from you to your people, Lord God. I pray that you would prepare the hearts of those that are in this building this morning and those that are watching online, Lord. I prepare their hearts to receive the word this morning, the seed that will be planted in their hearts, Lord, so that you can begin to water it and germinate it, and it can grow and it can bear fruit like your word says, Lord God. So just cover Sam under your blood. Give him the words to speak this morning, Lord God. Let him stand in love, the love that you have for him, Lord God. We just thank you, Lord God, for all that he does for this ministry, Lord. And we just pray that you just bless him throughout this message. We give you thanks for all those that are here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lisa. Oh, isn't she awesome? Yeah? Hey, good morning. This stage looks awesome. I was asking one of our young adults this morning how I'm supposed to preach the serious message today with all this fun stuff going on, because it makes me want to watch Ariel and The Little Mermaid. But I'm so glad that you could join us today. As Lisa was sharing with us, we are in a series right now. It's the three R's. It's relationships, which we covered in the month of June. Rest, which we are covering this month, and restoration, which will be in August. And so if you've been traveling with us and tracking with us, you have heard from Pastor Paul the last 2 weeks on the Sabbath and the importance of Sabbath and how that provides rest as we navigate through our lives. And today I want to share with you some potential problems with the day off, okay, with the day off. And I want to imagine with me, I don't know if you guys have ever had this before where you take a day off, but your mind doesn't take a day off. You ever have that where your mind doesn't take a day off? And so it could be something little like, this is a problem of mine, okay? We have this one person in our young adults ministry, and I always forget her name. Even this past Friday, and this she was a little upset, and she's, I help lead worship. You know, I bring leadership to our young adult ministry. How do you keep forgetting my name? Right? And I was like, sister, come on, you know? Sister. On the way home, I remember it. On the way home, it's E. Lisa. It can't just be Lisa. It has to be an E in front of it. And what happens in my mind, it starts going these places like, why is there an E? Just call yourself Lisa. I can remember Lisa. Stick the E in there. It throws everything off. But then my mind goes a little bit further and then starts thinking, man, I need to be a better pastor. And I got to remember their name. And it starts going into some deeper areas of saying, I don't feel like I'm a good pastor. Does that make sense? And so sometimes when there's silence or when there's moments of Sabbath, our minds can go places that, you know, sometimes we don't want to go. And some of those areas might be a little bit more difficult, like when it comes to our jobs, when it comes to navigating through some of the expectations in our lives. And so what do we do when we have these moments? So I brought this little illustration with me, okay? Let's pretend this box is your head, okay? All right, and you know, it's filled with all the busyness of life and busyness of all the different things that we go through. And this one thought comes into your head, right? Whether it's forgetting someone's name, you know, the expectations at work, whatever it may be, and it fills your head. Now, we're gonna put something in there, hold on. Let's put this quarter in there. And here's the problem with this quarter, because even though on the outside, your brain and everybody looks like there's nothing, you know, like you're all good. When people come up to you and say, how you doing? I'm good. But inside, you hear that? This is shaking around in your brain, right? That's what's happening. And so the question I want to ask is, as we're navigating through this time, is what do we do with those things that are rattling through our brains, okay? A better way to be asking this question of what's going on in your mind is, how is your sleep? How's your sleep? Sleep actually tells us a lot about how we're doing in our hearts and our minds. If we're wrestling in our sleep, sometimes, a lot of times, there's something that's wrestling in our minds. If you ever have like a big presentation that you have to do the next day, and you're like, I can't sleep, I can't eat. Our brains affect our sleep, right? And so there's a psalm in Psalm 23. It's one of my favorites. David shares, he says, he leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. Tim Keller says, this is the REM of the soul. What does it look like to have that peace? So the question I want to pose today, and hopefully we'll get into that deepness, is how do we get REM for the soul? What does it look like to have rest for the soul? I have this passage I want to read to you guys. It comes from Matthew chapter 11, verse 25 to 30. Most of us, hopefully, if you've been to church, you would know this. If you don't, please follow along. It says this: at that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things you have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. And then he says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. For a lot of our Jewish friends, when they would take a Sabbath, what they would do with their kids is they would give them a scoop of honey and give them that scoop, because that was the sweetest thing that they had. And say, as you eat this and as we do the Sabbath, may it be sweet to the soul. May it be sweet to the soul. Now, we don't have honey today, but we got ice cream. So after service, as you're eating your ice cream, may it be sweet to the soul, okay? Hopefully these words today will help you, remind you how it could be sweet to the soul. Three things I want us to navigate through today. Why do we need rest for our souls? What does rest for our souls look like? And how do we get that rest? Why do we need rest for the souls? What does rest for our souls look like? And how do we get that rest? Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. And some of you might be thinking, I'm not weary, I'm not burdened, I can check out in this sermon. Well, let me tell you this, okay? This might be hard for some of our youngins especially to understand, because you might have this perspective of what is a good state of mind. And some of you might be saying, if I find the right person, you know, life's gonna be good. Some of you guys might be saying, if I'm financially stable, I will be good. If I find the right job, I will be good. I'll be in a good state. And if I get to the university I want for our young adults or our youth, that I'll be good. But for those who are a little bit more seasoned in here, like myself, you would know that life, even when you get older, that you might achieve some of these things and you could still be looking for something. And you could still feel restless even when you get older. Here's the problem, okay? Because we're gonna navigate through desires. John Mark Comer states this, that desires are infinite. Desires are infinite, there's no limit. And here's the problem that I went through this week. Amazon Prime had Prime Day and for 2 days. And I'm flipping through and I desired a lot of things. I was telling my wife, we need electric toothbrushes, don't you? Don't we? Like, I'm tired of using my hands. Just and like, you just flip through and there's so many things that our heart desires. Our heart desires so many various things. And here's what is true. Some of those desires are stoked by the fire of advertisement. And it adds clutter. How many emails do we get about certain things that we want? How many emails do we get about, you know, weight loss and, you know, get smarter this way and, you know, get scholarships this way? How many emails and ads do we see? And this is what John Mark Comer says. He says, advertisements is an attempt to monetize our restlessness. Advertisement is an attempt to monetize our restlessness, because this is what is real. We are finite people. We're finite people. And we will never be able to experience all of our desires, will we? There's like, I mean, how many restaurants do I want to go to? And I'll never be able to experience all the various McDonald's in the world. You know, I won't be able to. I won't be able to experience, you know, all the different things of the world. And so here's what is true, is that for some of us, we live in this state of restlessness because of some of our desires that we have. Another way to call this desire is the life of anticipation. And the problem is this, that when you get there, you may feel temporary happiness till you have to anticipate the next thing. The lie that we live with is this, that if I receive this, I will be happy. If I get that, I will be happy. If I achieve this, I will be happy. If I get the right education, if I make the right money, if I live in the right house, if I, you know, get the right car, I will be happy. And then once you get it, then what? But the question is, what if you don't? Some of these things, like, what if I need my parents' approval? What if you don't get it? I need to meet the expectations of my boss. Well, what if you don't get it? What if you don't get it? Dallas Willard says this: desire is infinite because we are made by God, for God, made to need God, and made to run on God. And here's what is true. If we believe that God created us, okay, we're going with that surmise, that if we believe that God created us, if we believe that God created us in his image, and if we believe that God created us to love him, then shouldn't our desires revolve around that? Nothing apart from God will ever satisfy our desires, because our desires are infinite. They are. We are finite, and we will live in restlessness at best, or worse, in frustration, anger, disillusionment, which will sometimes lead to a life of busyness, shopping on Amazon recklessly, and a life that's based on other people's opinions sometimes. And so today, Jesus is saying, I am the only one that can give you rest. I am the only one. Jesus says this: come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. What does that look like? I don't know if you guys know this, but during COVID time, I started having breathing issues. So I would exercise. I know it doesn't look like it. I do exercise, okay? I was exercising, and I would be breathing extra heavily. And I would wake up in the middle of the night gasping for air. And my mind went to some of the worst places, right? It's gonna be the sea, isn't it? Or, you know, there's something wrong with my lungs or my heart, or there's something about getting 40 that all of a sudden feels like things are deteriorating. And I had this. It was taking a big part of my mind. And it was occupying just every aspect. And I'd be sitting there thinking about it. And so I tried to distract my mind from this breathing issue that I had. I went to go see doctors about it. And it was just in the top of my mind all the time. I found out I have asthma, okay? That's what it was. I developed asthma over COVID, right? But it was this voice that was constantly in my head: there's something wrong with you. yeah, get this fixed. What if it's cancer? What if it's this? What if you have heart problems? And just your mind sometimes goes to some of the worst places ever, right? Without anything. It just spirals sometimes. What is that voice that's in your head that when it gets silent, that your head gets noisy? What is that voice? I used to hate Sabbaths because my mind would go to places that would spiral. It would spiral. Jesus says to that, I want to give you rest. For some of us, maybe it's not meeting the standards of our parents or various expectations or wishing you can go back in time. Sometimes I have that in my brain where, man, I wish I could go back and do this. I live in the regret of this. And Jesus says, let me help you with that. But here's the problem. Sometimes what we do to kind of conquer over some of those thoughts is we choose to be busy. We fill it with, for me, video games, right? For others, it might be eating. For some, it might be super exercising or watching Netflix or whatever it may be, that we fill our brains so that we don't have to sit in the silence and don't have to listen to those things. But that's just kind of masking things here. The biblical understanding of the Sabbath is not just the day of rest, but is the day of rest for your soul. Now, I'm going to share with you something that is going to be a little bit radical. Hopefully it's not, okay? But for some of us, this might be like, I don't know, okay? But Jesus says this, if you want rest, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, and you will find rest for your soul, okay? Now, if you don't know what a yoke is, okay, a yoke was this kind of like this modern time thing where they would strap two animals together so that it would pull a plow or a cart or whatever it may be. And usually they would put like an oxen or some sort of mule and it would just go. Now, what they would do is you wouldn't strap two young mules together. Usually you would strap a young mule or a young oxen with a veteran. And the reason why you strap them with a veteran is so that the veteran would teach them how to plow. Because this is what happens if you strap just two new mules together. It's like they don't know the speed. They don't know the tempo. They don't know where they're going. But the veteran, he knows. He knows, okay? And so Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, right? Take my yoke upon you. Michael Wilkins says this, the image was used metaphorically to describe one's individual subjection to another, meaning this, it's a metaphor for discipleship. For discipleship. Now back then, if you don't know what a disciple is, and that's fine. What a disciple did back then is, if they were going to be discipled by a rabbi, which was some of the highest calling, right? It's like being called up to the NBA, right? If you're going to be discipled by a rabbi, you would go and live with the rabbi. You would follow the rabbi. And everything the rabbi would do, you would do. If they ate with their left hand, you would eat with your left hand. Everything that they would do, you would do. And so you can imagine, right? Disciples being a high calling, really excited. When Jesus calls these fishermen to become disciples, they leave their nets and everything. Like, yeah, of course. And they leave everything and they go. And there's this moment where Jesus is walking on the water. No life preserver, nothing. And what happens? Peter gets out. He gets out of the boat. And no life preservers. And he starts walking on water. Why does he do it? Because his rabbi is doing it first, right? And he's freaking out. He's like, what is he doing? Walking on water. But he does it because the rabbi did it first, okay? This is discipleship. You follow the rabbi. You follow the rabbi. just like how they were yoked together, okay? This is what discipleship is. In this sense, what Jesus is saying, when you come yoke with me, he says, let me dominate your life. Let me tell you and instruct you. Let me show you the direction. Now, here's the problem, is that most of North America is going to come up to me later and say, I don't want nobody telling me how to live my life. I want to tell God to yoke himself to me, right? Like, you should yoke to me. I'm going to tell you where to go. That's what North America usually says, doesn't it? I'm going to tell you what's right or wrong. I'm going to tell you how we're going to live this life. I'm going to dictate how life is going to go. And Jesus says, no. If you really want rest for your soul, you got to be yoked to me. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. And what he's really saying is everybody is restless. Everybody is burdened. And everybody is weary. And what he's really saying is this, okay? He says, take my yoke. The reason why he's saying take my yoke, because you already have a yoke. And that yoke right now is causing you that weariness. I think we just think that we're not carrying a yoke right now, right? But the reality is we do have a yoke on, and it's attached right now to some of our desires, some of those expectations, some of those things in our minds that's telling us we need to go here. And this is what we might be yoked to currently right now. And Jesus says, no, take that yoke off and put my yoke on. Take that yoke off and put my yoke on. Everybody, believe it or not, lives for something. And whatever you decide to be living for, you are yoked to it. Everybody lives for something. Whether it's yourself, whether it's your job, whether it's for money, whether it's for prestige, whether it's for, you know, shopping. We all live for something. And we are yoked to whatever that thing we are living for. We are yoked to it. And what ends up happening is when we're yoked to it, that thing directs a lot of where we're going. It directs our minds, our thought processes, and it is going to drive us bonkers. And Jesus says, I don't want that for you. Jesus says, take my yoke. He says, I'm the only master that if you yoke with me, that I am gentle and humble. I am gentle and humble. He's saying, you are yoked to something already and you are not spiritually free, but if you yoke with me, whatever that is, you know, like if you're yoked to your job and you get fired, your job doesn't care about you, right? They'll find somebody else. If you're yoked to something outside of Jesus, right? All there is this disappointment, hurt, and pain. And what Jesus says is, I am gentle. I am humble. When you mess up, I'm with you. When you screw up, I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to get you back on track. When you're trying to get off, don't worry. Since you're yoked to me, I'm going to get you back on track. You're moving too fast? Don't worry. I'm going to set the pace in your life. Be yoked to me. Psalm 23, David says, you lead me beside quiet waters. He doesn't say, I lead myself and God meets me there. No. You lead me beside quiet waters. You restore my soul. You lead me. You lead me. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. Why? For you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. Here's a man that was yoked to God. And here's the great thing about David. Some of you guys might not know this about David, but David would go to war. And kings back then, they were the number one target, okay? Number one target. So kings back then, they would have problems sleeping. Because they're wondering, am I going to die tomorrow when I go to war? David says, I'm sleeping like a baby because I know where my heart is. My soul finds rest. He knew what it meant to have the REM of the soul. I hope some of us are saying, I want that. I want that. So the question is, how do we get it? Okay, how do we get it? Verse 25, it says this, at that time, Jesus says, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and on earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. And early in that chapter, Jesus refers to some who were trying to have this heart of a child, but were being pushed by a yoke of something else. And he says, to what can I compare this generation? They are like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling out to others. We played the pipe for you and we did not dance. We sang a dirge and you did not mourn. What's interesting is prior to section, these verses 20 to 24, Jesus speaks to a bunch of towns where he had gone around. They called this the evangelical triangle, where Jesus went around to these specific cities and did all these miracles. And you would think that after all those miracles that all these people would be like, oh, praise Jesus. A lot of them, many of them, just kept going on being yoked to what they were used to. You would think even after all those miracles that Jesus did, that they were like, I'm gonna follow you, but many of them didn't. And so what does it take to be yoked with God, with Jesus? Jesus says, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. He says, be like a child. Don't be childish. I don't want you going around with a rattle. All right, I don't see that. He says, have a heart like a child. Tim Keller says there are at least two ways that you become like a child and become a Christian. Two ways. One, they're helpless and they are confident of love. One, they're helpless and they're confident of love. Some of you guys might know I was a chaplain at a school called Holy Trinity, and I would teach Bible classes to kindergarten all the way to grade 5. And some of my favorite groups was the kindergarten classes. And I would sit there with the kindergarten classes, and I don't know if you've ever taught kindergarten, but like for some reason, there's like a constant flow of like snot all the time. And if it's not constant flowing, they're picking it, right? And I remember this one kid, it's just flowing, okay? And I feel so bad. And I said, hey, so-and-so, can I help you? And he's like, yeah. And he comes up and he wipes his nose on my sleeve. You feel better now? I said, yeah. So do I. I was sick all throughout October, November, December. You know, kids are so helpless. I all the time they need help. Help me tie my shoelace. Kids, they have their shoes on backwards sometimes, right? Or they put their pants on backwards or their snow pants on backwards. And I'm like, what? You know, what? What? Sometimes the gloves are on backwards. They have thumbs, bro, right? And so these kids are just helpless, and they're always asking for help. And it was always like, Pastor Chung, help me. And what Jesus says is become like a child. He says you got to swallow your pride and know that you don't know all the right pathways forward. You don't know. We don't know all the right pathways forward. We don't. Is being helpless is when we know that we can't save ourselves. We can't. We can't save ourselves. Number two, little children are confident in love. Being confident in love. One of my favorite moments in church, seeing when, I don't know if you guys noticed this, but when parents are picking up their kids, And it's just awesome. Like, kids are just like slow motion running to their parents. And then they just, I was like, oh, that's so nice. And there's this confidence of love. Like, they know that even though their parents have gone to service, they're coming back. And I miss you. And you know, there's this confidence that they love you and care for you. Then they become teenagers. They're like, what happened? Right? But kids, you know, my son, he stuck the micro USB into a USB-C, and he just kept shoving it in there into the computer, and it wasn't working after a while. He's like, Dad, it's not fitting. I said, it's the wrong cord. Now it's not charging. And he's like, ah! But he knows that I will still love him. Now, here's what is true. Some of us might say, how can Jesus love me? I'm too bad. Or some of us might be saying that love has been abused in my life, and I don't trust it. And Jesus says this. He says, be confident, because I am humble and gentle. You know, when Jesus came, he came on the scene, people were looking for a warrior. They were looking for a warrior. Even John the Baptist was questioning him. He was saying, yo, what's going on here? I was expecting a warrior, and you're just like all nice, right? And Jesus came as a lamb. He could have came as a lion, but he came as a lamb. Jesus didn't come to bring judgment, but to bear judgment. If you want to understand the heart of Jesus, you got to see the cross. It's interesting. If you look in the book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 54 to 60, there's a man named Stephen, who's one of the disciples of Jesus. He's getting stoned. And as he's getting stoned, his life is passing. He says, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He falls to his knees and cries out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And then in scripture it says that he falls asleep, or in another way, he says he dies in peace. But for Jesus, when he's on the cross, similar thing. He says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. But instead of peace, he cries out to the Father and says, why have you forsaken me? For Stephen, he would die in peace. But for Jesus, he would die and take the penalty. And some say that he would taste the cosmic restlessness that we have experienced and says, I want to take that for you so that you don't have to. I want to take that for you so that you don't have to. Back to our analogy. I'm going to break the moment for a little bit, all right? Okay. So I have my quarter here. And we'll shake it around, right? And sometimes what happens when we are yoked with Jesus, still in there, when we are yoked with Jesus and we have those thoughts don't go away necessarily, okay? But what happens when we're yoked to Jesus, it doesn't rattle anymore around in our brain. It's still there, right? Oop. I broke it. It's still there, but doesn't rattle anymore. Sometimes, as we are yoked to Jesus, sometimes it disappears. Sometimes. My prayer for each one of us is that you will have rest for your soul. You will have rest for your soul. As you're taking some ice cream today, my prayer is that it will remind you of how sweet it is to be yoked to Jesus. How sweet it is to be yoked to Jesus. Would you pray with me? Let's pray. Hey God, thank you so much that because you would decide to die for us and choose this cosmic restlessness on our behalf, that we can find peace. And though these thoughts might not necessarily go away, that as we are yoked with you, that doesn't rattle in our brains anymore, that you help us navigate through those thoughts. And hopefully sometimes those thoughts aren't there anymore because we are yoked with you, God. So thank you, Lord. I pray, God, if there's anyone that is new to this idea of Jesus, that they will find rest today. In Jesus' name.
I just invite you to sing these words together, to say, I will exalt you, Jesus. When we exalt him in our lives, then he is put in the rightful place, and everything else finds its right place when he is the center. So let's sing together. I will exalt you.
Let's declare.
It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. It is well.
Hey, that's my prayer for all of us. Thank you, team, for leading us through that song, that it would be well with your soul, that you would have rest for your soul. And if you have any questions there afterwards about who Jesus is, how this operates, you're in love. We have a great prayer team that wants to pray with you and kind of lead you through this understanding for what it looks like to be helpless and to have a God that loves us endlessly. That if you have questions about that, please go see our prayer team. They want to pray with you and hopefully walk with you through some of that stuff. Secondly, for those that are here, if you can help me out, as you can see, we have ABC happening here today. This coming, it's like starting tomorrow, they have ABC, but we need to clear some of these chairs out. And I know, again, like, I know I work out, I don't look like it, but I need your help. And so if you can help clear some of these chairs, you don't have to leave the ones on the sides and the balcony, don't worry about those ones, but here in this middle section and these areas all the way across, if you do have like 5 minutes, if we were all do it together, we can bang this out real quick. Love and appreciate if you can help me out with that. And I think Pastor Veronica will be around to kind of help bring some leadership to that. Outside of that, please enjoy ice cream. All right, for those that are lactose intolerant, there's freezies as well. And so please enjoy this Sunday with the summer and lots of love. We'll see you next week.